Good morning, Elgin Missionary Church, and welcome once again to Church Online. Whether you're here with us for the first time or you're here with us every single week, we are so glad that you've chosen to join our online service today. And I encourage you, if you would like to get into contact with someone from the church, please look in the description below for contact info. And we hope that everyone is blessed by this service. And without further ado, let's pray and get this service underway. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this week. I pray a blessing over the week to come, and thank you for the week that was. All the highs and lows and everything that comes with this, you know, this life that you've given us. I pray that we can retreat and just be refreshed and rejuvenated and revived by this service from the preaching of the word and the worship together. In Jesus' amazing name I pray, and I'm not ashamed. Amen. Enjoy the service.
Darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow tries to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, oh, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken, 'cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your chance when I stand in your
Let's declare this. Let's declare this over our lives.
Oh, I am standing on the rock. Yeah, I am standing in your love. Yeah, I am standing on the rock. My firm foundation, my firm foundation. We sing it. Oh, I am standing.
Answers far and wide, but I know it's love so undeniable. I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our service this morning. It is so good that you are with us this morning. Before I bring today's message, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock, my strength, and my redeemer. In Jesus' name, amen. Our reading this morning is from Isaiah 44, verses 1 to 5. Now, if you have your Bible handy, it would be great if you could grab it and just follow along. I'm going to look at each verse one at a time. If your Bible's not handy, you can always hit pause and come back and join us when you have your Bible. So Isaiah chapter 44, verses 1 to 5. But now listen, O Jacob, my servant, Israel, whom I have chosen. This is what the Lord says. He who made you, who formed you in the womb, and who will help you. Do not be afraid, O Jacob, my servant, Jeshurun, whom I have chosen. For I will pour water on the thirsty land and streams on the dry ground. I will pour out my spirit on your offspring and my blessing on your descendants. They will spring up like grass in a meadow, like poplar trees by flowing streams. One will say, I belong to the Lord. Another will call himself by the name of Jacob. Still another will write on his hand the Lord's and will take the name Israel. I have enjoyed and celebrated the various stages in my children's lives as they grew. I'm sure many of you can relate. Some of those times were very emotional. Like when they went to school for the very first time, they were so little. I'm sure I'm not the only one who got excited when they came home with a ribbon from cross country or when their science project made it to the fair. Even for me, their school pictures were exciting. I have three children, and every year I looked for those 8x10 school pictures. I had three picture frames on the wall, one for each of them, and every year I would take that picture frame off the wall, and I would take all the pictures that had been set one in front of the other. I always put the most recent one on top, but I would lay out all those pictures in a row, and I would look at them and their changes in their lives. Those toddlers, the little chubby cheeks in those first years of school, nursery school, and then primary one, primary two, primary three. And then we came to Canada, and then grade school and high school and university. And I would study them, and I would look at their faces and how they changed. Those years where they had teeth missing, then the braces, the hairstyles. And it was just wonderful to see each year all those changes in their lives. You know, we watched our children as they went from elementary school to high school, as they learned to drive. We cried, I cried, when we took our oldest to Western University in London. I cried when we took our second to firefighting college in Alberta. He was so far away, and we left him there alone. I cried when our youngest and only daughter got married. I felt I'd served my purpose. Now what am I going to do? We were empty nesters, and that was really an adjustment for us. We watched them leave our home one by one to begin their own homes and their own families. And now they are having the same experiences with their children. Each step, special and unique and worth celebrating. Children are often so impatient to grow up. They want to feed themselves before they have developed fine motor skills. I'm sure you can think of those days when your little one was trying to feed themselves spaghetti and it was everywhere. They wanted to walk to school on their own. But mommy, I'm a big boy. I'm 5. You know, they wished they could drive. They wished they were done school and able to work. It's like they were wishing their lives away. Now, I don't know about you, but if you're like me, I sometimes think like children. When am I going to grow up in the Lord? Am I ever going to go higher and further and deeper with him? When will I see his promises come to life in me? Fortunately, we have his promise that a life in Jesus is never wasted. But growth is a process. We can be sure that if we continue in him, we will get to where he wants us to be, no matter what. Hey, maybe his promises are already being fulfilled in your life right now, and we just don't see it for what it is. You need to look back over the years and see how you've changed from where you've been to where you are now. It's like pulling out those school pictures and seeing those little changes and comparing from the first time to now. We're all in different stages of development spiritually, and your physical age does not impact your spiritual age. But you can be sure that the Lord is right there with you. Every day, God is answering the question, what should I be when I grow up? The answer is faithful. He wants you to be faithful. Let's look at verse 1 together. It says, but now listen, O Jacob, my servant Israel, whom I have chosen. This is for those who wonder where God is in their lives. Now, I have a good friend who says to me, now, listen to me. And when I hear that, I know I'm going to receive some word of wisdom or encouragement. The very opening words of this text is God saying, now, listen. The definition of the word listen means pay attention closely for the purpose of hearing. This message was originally intended for the nation of Israel, but notice how God also refers to Israel by another name, Jacob. Jacob was a deceiver. He tricked his father into giving him the blessing intended for his brother Esau. Even though Jacob was called by God to be the father of many nations, he somehow thought he had to help God make that happen by stealing his brother's birthright. So when God refers to the nation of Israel, he's reminding them where it was they came from when he first called them. Not only does God remind them of their past, but he also mentions how he sees them now, his servants. God wants them to know that he is the one who chose them. Now listen, I want you to understand what this is saying. God chose you. You may have made the decision to accept Jesus into your life. You may be the one who has decided to live for him. It may be your choice to be everything that he wants you to be. But all of those decisions are because God chose you. Jesus told his disciples in John 16, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last." When God chose you, a seed was planted. Something was sown in you. A desire, a hope, a gift, a talent, an experience. Jeremiah 1 verse 5 says, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart." I want you to understand the significance of this fact. If God knew you and chose you before you were ever born, that means he has a plan for your life. And that plan was to bear fruit. Before you can ever bear fruit, you have to be planted. Before you can be planted, you must be willing to submit to God. When that happens, he sows into you. Now let's look at verse 2. It reads, "This is what the Lord says. He who made you, who formed you in the womb, and who will help you. Do not be afraid, O Jacob, my servant, Jeshurun, whom I have chosen." In this verse, God uses the name Jeshurun. It's another symbolic name for Israel, and it means upright. Do you see what God is saying to Israel? First, he reminds them that they were like Jacob, the deceiver, but eventually they will become Jeshurun, upright. That is the way God is working in your life right now. When you were first planted in the Lord, you were a baby. I'm talking about when you were first saved. Let's read another scripture. Now, keep your finger in Isaiah 44 and go to 1 Corinthians 1, verse 1, and let's begin at verse 25. So this is 1 Corinthians 1, chapter 1, starting at verse 25. "For the foolishness of God is wiser than man's wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than man's strength. Brothers, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth, but God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. He chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God, that is, a righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let him who boasts, boast in the Lord. You can boast in the Lord because God is taking you from being a Jacob to a Jeshurun. Now, let's go back to Isaiah 44 and look at verse 3. For I will pour water on the thirsty land and streams on the dry ground. I will pour out my spirit on your offspring and my blessing on your descendants. What an incredible verse. God is growing you by watering you. Once the seed is sown in you, God does not forget about you and say, good luck, I hope you do well. No, he plants you and he will water you and tend to you. He will give you the nourishment and attention that you need because growth is a process. Some of you may have heard of the comedian Yakov Smirnoff. He said that when he first came to the United States from Russia, he wasn't prepared for the incredible variety of instant products available in North American grocery stores. He says, on my first shopping trip, I saw powdered milk. You just add water and you get milk. Then I saw powdered orange juice. You just add water and you get orange juice. Then I saw baby powder and I thought to myself, what a great country. One of the most basic assumptions made about life change is that it happens instantly at salvation. Some people believe when someone gives his or her life to Christ, there's an immediate, in-depth, miraculous change in habits, attitudes, and character. And as a result, disciples are instant, not developed. The question for rethinking that belief is this: are these assumptions valid? If they are, then working this formula in the life of the church should consistently give the same result at salvation. An instant new community of people who are becoming increasingly like Jesus in their life and thought. If that is not what a church experiences, then it needs to rethink whether the formula is sound. Unfortunately, many churches are not getting the correct answer. In fact, a Search Institute study has found that only 11% of church-going teenagers have a well-developed faith, rising to only 32% for church-going adults. Why? Because true life change only begins at salvation. It's not instant. It takes more than just time. It's about training, not trying. And it's about team effort. God says, you are planted. And once you are planted, he will give you every opportunity to grow into what he wants you to be. And he has done that because he has poured out his Spirit. Let's look at verse 3 again. For I will pour water on the thirsty land and streams on the dry ground. I will pour out my Spirit on your offspring and my blessing on your descendants. Do you understand that God grows individuals and churches in the same way? He says, in the last days, I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. That happened on the day of Pentecost, and the purpose was to empower believers, but it also grew the church. Acts chapter 2 verse 41 says those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. Spiritual growth is always brought about by the work of the Holy Spirit. You cannot grow spiritually without the work of the Holy Spirit in your life, for it is the Holy Spirit who enlightens Scripture to you. It is the Holy Spirit who teaches you. It is the Holy Spirit who empowers you. It is the Holy Spirit who gives gifts to you. It is the Holy Spirit that convicts you of sin unto repentance. It is the same Spirit that will always go where you go. Psalm 139 verse 7 says, "Where can I go from your Spirit? Where can I flee from your presence?" The answer is nowhere. Jesus said this in John 7:38. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, streams of living water will flow from within him. By this he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Not only does God sow into you, but he also provides water for growth, both as the church and as individuals. And do you see what he provides with the spiritual growth? He says, I will pour out my Spirit on your offspring and my blessing on your descendants. As long as you strive to grow in the Lord, you are receiving the promise of blessing for your children and for your grandchildren, because your life influences them and blesses them, and then both you and they flourish. Let's look at verse 4. They will spring up like grass in a meadow, like poplar trees by flowing streams. When a seed is planted properly in good soil and then watered and fed the right food, growth is inevitable. In the British Weekly, a provocative letter was published some time ago, and it reads like this. Dear Sir, it seems ministers feel their sermons are very important and spend a great deal of time preparing them. I have been attending church quite regularly for 30 years, and I have probably heard 3,000 of them. To my consternation, I discovered I cannot remember a single sermon. I wonder if a minister's time might be more profitably spent on something else. For weeks, a storm of editorial responses ensued, finally ended by this letter. Dear Sir, I have been married for 30 years. During that time, I have eaten 32,850 meals, mostly my wife's cooking. Suddenly, I have discovered I cannot remember the menu of a single meal. And yet, I have the distinct impression that without them, I would have starved to death long ago. You see, it's the Word of God and the work of the Holy Spirit in you and in the church that takes you from being Jacob, the deceiver, to Jeshurun, the upright. Now let's move on to verse 5. It reads, "One will say, I belong to the Lord. Another will call himself by the name of Jacob. Still another will write on his hand, the Lord's, and will take the name Israel." Israel means he will rule as God. And that is the place where the planting and watering will take you. You will flourish because God is ruling in you. His spirit is now in control. The flesh has lost all its power. The enemy can try to get you to feed on the desires of the world, but your spirit says, I don't want that anymore. I don't need that anymore. I'm not going to do that anymore. Satan, you've been in control long enough, but I have been planted. I have been watered, and I am flourishing in this life in the spirit. There is a river of life flowing in you and through you, and it's watering the dry places and filling you up with the word. I started out talking about my children and how I chose to rejoice in every stage of life that they went through. I can honestly say I have enjoyed every single stage of our kids' lives, from toddlers to children to teens, young adults, and now parents themselves. Now listen to me. I want you to know something important. God, as your Heavenly Father, is experiencing that with you right now. As you grow, he rejoices. When you fall back, he's there to pick you up. If you turn away for a time, he grieves over you, but continues to send his spirit to call you back. He does that because he is the one who has sown into your life. He is the one who has watered. He is the one who causes you to flourish. And every time you take a step toward him, you bring glory to his name. If you're struggling in some area of your life, here is a word of encouragement for you to think about. This is an example that I received from listening to Graham Cook. We can all relate to this, whether it's your children, your grandchildren, a sibling, a neighbor, or even when babysitting. Think about this. When children are young and just learning to walk, they will stand by the couch and just cruise along the edge of the couch, right? Sometimes they'll stand tentatively for a few seconds and then grab the couch again. As a parent, you know they are ready to walk on their own. And you get down on the floor and encourage them to come toward you. And they get all excited. You say, come on, come on. And they wobble and they look like they're going to take that step, but they cheat and they get down on the floor and they crawl toward you. What do? You don't get angry with them. You're not upset with them because you know this is a process. You pick them up and you give them a big hug and you twirl them around and you set them right back at the couch and you say, come on, come on. And it doesn't matter how often they fail to walk to you. It doesn't matter how often they cheat. You enjoy the process with them. You love to see their excitement. You love to see their shaky attempts, and you are not disappointed in them because you know it's a process and every child is different. God is not disappointed in our failures. He is not focused on our failures. He's focused on your growth in Him. He wants you to flourish, to thrive in your walk with Him. And He's focused on your willingness to step out for Him, your attempts to step out of your comfort zone. You and I are continually in a process of growing up, and God loves being in that process with you. So let's keep growing. Allow the Holy Spirit to pour out water on your thirsty soul so that you will bear fruit. Let's allow God to pour out His Spirit on our offspring and His blessing on our children as we continue to thrive and bear the fruit. Others will benefit from that fruit that we produce. We all know that fruit has seeds, so when we get to plant a seed in someone else, that will enable God to sow into them, to water them, and to watch them flourish and thrive. And you are destined to grow. When a seed is sown in you and watered and fed the right food, it will flourish and grow and thrive. And perhaps Elgin Missionary Church will reap the harvest. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that you love us, that you enjoy the process, that you are not disappointed when we let you down. But you love it when we take those shaky attempts to step out for you. When we step out of our comfort zone. When we take a step towards you in fear and trembling. You love to be in that process with us. Thank you that you are a loving Heavenly Father. And dear Lord, I would like to proclaim this scripture text over those listening and over Elgin Missionary Church. Now listen, Elgin Missionary Church, my servants whom I have chosen. This is what the Lord says. He who made you, who formed you in the womb, and who will help you. Do not be afraid, Elgin, my servants whom I have chosen. For I will pour water on the thirsty land and streams on the dry ground. I will pour out my Spirit on your kids' programs and my blessing on your ministries. They will spring up like grass in a meadow, like poplar trees by flowing streams. And some will say, I belong to the Lord. Others will be seekers who will write on their hand the Lord's and commit their lives to God and will take the name Christian. I pray, Father, that what comes next will not take away from what you're speaking into hearts this morning. I pray your continued blessing on this church family, and I pray that this church will be Spirit-led from this day forward. In Jesus' name, amen.
That the highest King would welcome me. I was lost, but He brought me in. Oh, His love for me. Oh, His love for me. Oh, the sun sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child.